our side of the people. I've just gotten the most wonderful thing here written as a scenario by a minister.
Who are you?
In Detroit, First Presbyterian Church. They had a program with a $35,000 grant, a summer program for kids in the neighborhood. And they took, you know, field trips and all this sort of thing, and then a couple of meals a day and all that while they were doing it. And they began to hear about the, you know, the things that we were doing, and it was going to be cut back. And then this minister's written this very well. It's the first meetings that they had, and goes on the successive meetings, and how this thing grew, in which the church just said, well, you know, we ought to find a way to do it, instead of quitting. And how the committees were formed and everything, and then they'd never contacted the mothers of the kids. They'd never been able to reach them, they just dealt with their kids. So they then invited the mothers to come in for a meeting. These mothers were not mothers of the church. I mean, in the church, they were just neighborhood, any connection. And out of it has come, they enlisted the aid of the mothers. The mothers are now joining the church and coming into church regularly. And it's the most inspiring story. I'm going to have Kathy make some copies of this for several departments here and all. But it is, Gordon Irvine reported to the Detroit Presbytery staff following his November 22nd experience at First Church that in his opinion, First Church is the most integrated congregation he knows of in the country. He used the word integrated. He was still trying to put together his feelings a few days after that service, how First Church integrates retarded adults with college graduates, senior citizens with neighborhood youth. And I tell you, it's and it all started because they thought we were going to cut off 35, and I guess we did.
Detroit Church.
Why not? Why not? That would help. The business is in bad shape. They need a little help. So, can we go ahead and now?
Yes,
all right,
sure.
Ladies and gentlemen here.
Okay.
Well, Mr. President, the past several weeks, I've met with a number of really fine builders in the Southern California area, in Irvine. And more recently, I've met with some leading builders in New York City at a construction conference there. And at all these places, the mood and the theme were the same. The mood was one of despair, and the theme was that the housing industry is in its worst economic condition since World War II. And there are facts to support that mood and that theme, because there have been seven economic recessions for the building industry since the end of World War II, and they're in their seventh right now. And it is the most devastating. It's the longest one they've ever had. It's gone over 3 years. Actually, it's about 39 months right now, and it's continuing.
That's the important thing, if I could interrupt.
Yes.
Because they're saying, what is the truth? It started in 78.
Oh, yes. It's over 3 years. It started, yes, about 78. It's about 3 years. It's 39 months, to be exact, and that's a long time. That's 12 months longer than any other previous recession. Now, there's an added problem to this particular recession, and it's finance. If interest rates should drop tomorrow to a satisfactory level, there would be insufficient financial resources available for the industry to make a rapid recovery. And the reason for that is that in the past, as they came out of these recessions, they always had the S&Ls and mutual savings banks available to supply the money to come out of it. Now the S&Ls and the savings banks are in deep trouble themselves, so it's very difficult for them to depend on that source of money for financing. So that's another problem they've got. There's very severe unemployment in the industry today. In terms of numbers, there's about 925,000 salaried construction workers and about another 225,000 self-employed construction workers, making a total of something less than 1.2 million construction workers in this country unemployed. The unemployment rate for construction workers is about 18.7%, which is more than double the 8.9% rate for the nation's entire workforce. One out of every 10 people who is unemployed today is a construction worker. Now, this recession has caused many companies in the housing industry to either go out of business or to go into bankruptcy. And there's every indication that that will happen again and again in the future unless something's done. Now, I want to make it very clear, I don't consider myself a spokesman for the housing industry, but I do feel as though I should be somewhat of a spokesman for housing. It's one of my primary objectives for the people of this country to have adequate, decent, affordable housing, and for the United States to have a housing standard for its people that ranks among the best in the world. In order to attain this goal, it is necessary to...
Nice to see you.
I just wanted to tell you that the President of the French Republic will be very glad to come to visit you, and trying to arrange that with the State Department.
Well, it's always a pleasure to see him. Listen, let us go over and have an official photo taken in front of the fireplace, and then we'll call you in for one of all three of us. Doing this with the cameras,
yes.
Changing our envelopes here. And welcome again.
Thank you.
Now, middle. Next, please. Thank you, sir. All right. Well, delighted to have you here.
It's a country which I know for a very long time. I've been in this country for 35 years in business.
Yes, and I know.
Very glad to be back again.
Well,
permanently.
Well, that's wonderful. Yes, I know you're.
This country is a great country, and we certainly have a lot to try and improve the friendship between our two countries.
Well, I'm sure we shall.
I hope this visit of our president should be able to have it organized, and thoughts would be very fruitful, I hope so.
Well, I know it will. We shall see you soon.
This is Fiat.
Hello. Nice to see you.
She was in California. She's still in California.
Yes, in
California. While you were gone.
Well.
Beautiful.
Yes, I'm perpetually homesick.
Don't blame me. It's a beautiful state.
Well, we shall go over and have a picture taken in front of the fireplace, and then you will join us, and we'll have a picture of all three. And that'll be the best thing.
Thank you.
All right. And
thank you very much.
Thank you and welcome. All right. Now.
This is the best of all.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Well, welcome to Washington.
Thank you very much.
Well, I know you've had an experience here in our country before, Harvard University.
Yes, I was 4 years. You know, it's town, Boston. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I won't tell any jokes about Harvard then. No, I'm not a Yale man. Yes, well, now today in Texas. Florida yesterday. I've just heard, I wish that we could keep secrets as well in Washington as the Chamber of Commerce has kept them in Florida. I just found out today from Bill Rogers that for 3 days there has been no swimming in Key Biscayne and Biscayne Bay. There are 300 sharks that have moved into the bay. I don't know who counts them, but that's what they 300 sharks. Well, again, welcome.
Thank you. President, my father was right. He said the president is the most great challenge because he's an artist, and I am an artist. He's an artist, my father. He was a.
Well.
Yes. 72 now. He was a great challenge. All artists are. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
You.
Bye.
Fireplace for photo. Well, I'm looking forward to thinking that maybe I'll meet your Prime Minister Charles when I'm in Barbados.
She's looking forward very much to meeting you in April.
Oh, that's great.
She told me that she hopes I can extend the welcome of the Caribbean to you.
Well, well, we hope that we can exchange our papers here now. All right. Thank you. Well, we hope that our plan and closer relationship with the Caribbean nations is going to bear fruit, and we're very enthused about it.
We are very enthused with the initiative you've taken on the Caribbean Basin, and particularly the security of this area, because we feel that this is going to spell a lot of prosperity and peace for the region.
Well, that's what we hope, yes.
And my government wishes me to thank you very much for your assistance, especially during immediately after the hurricane, when you so readily sent the armed forces, and the continued support that you've given us with aid and technical advice and things like that. And wish the people of the United States through you all the very best. And personally, I'd like to offer my felicitations for the success of your tour abroad, your term of office.
Well, thank you very much. Welcome to Washington.
Thank you very much, Mr. President.
All right.
Mr. President, the Ambassador of the State of Israel.
Yes, Mr. Ambassador.
It's a great honor and a great pleasure.
Well, our pleasure. Honored to have you here.
And Mrs. Evans.
Hello there. Nice to see you. You and I will go over in front of the fireplace, have a picture taken, and then you'll come in and join us for another picture.
That's the letters on you.
Yes, this we'll do right to...
It's really a great privilege for me. I'm looking forward to this.
Well,
nice to meet you.
Well, we're pleased to have you here. I have just, I suppose, presume you know that I have just sent off a letter to...
Yes, I know about that. The Prime Minister called me this morning. He's very concerned, as I think you know.
Yes. He had not yet received my letter.
Right, but I'm sure that'll help some.
Well, I think that all of this one was spawned in the newspapers and the press reporting, and they created a fuss that was entirely unnecessary, and I hope that my letter will reassure him.
Well, I'm sure that's going to be helpful. But he, of course, is concerned about the perception. And the last is the letter that the Prime Minister asked me to give to Mr. President.
All right. Go ahead. Thank you very much.
And this is the speech you were going to make.
No, that's just a letter. I'm reading and restating our relationship with Israel, which remains what it always was, and what I discussed with him sitting in these two chairs when he was here.
Well, I came back very impressed from that meeting. Well, I was at that time in the Council of Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee, and he came to report to us. I came back very impressed.
Well, I think, I just, if we can survive these things that the press dreams of and so forth.
Well, I'm going to work at it very hard, and I feel like I've got a modest contribution to make here.
Well, please see you. Welcome. Oh, wait a minute. Now, we're not finished with pictures yet. Here we go. Almost forgot that we haven't taken the most important picture.
Bet you're not running for office anymore. You don't bring me these pictures, do you?
No, these are... this is, I figure, is evidence, you see, that you can have that
it's important for us.
We're here.
Very important.
I have evidence that...
It really took place.
No, thank you.
Thank you.